Hello, hello.
Hello, Gisia.
Hello, Isabel. Okay, what a pleasure to have you here today. So today I'm very happy to have you in this what can I say, interview about what you do. And you obviously people know you as a doctor. Isabel Almeida, a teacher, a writer, and you're writing books for children. They are beautiful, colored, and unique. And I would like to ask you to introduce yourself, even if I briefly I give you some.
I teach performing arts children because I want them to be creative and remember have power in their life. I want them to remember they have imagination and emotional intelligence. So singing, acting, and dancing, that's how I've disguised my powers. Gone in on this traditional path, but I'm allowed to do whatever I want. I did a PhD so that I could do what I want. So that studied all about how children react with their natural environment and become stewards of nature. So that was very, very important to me. And as a result, I've been a professional singer and dancer too. And I studied landscape architecture. So it's all about nature, human nature, creativity, imagination, and awakening that in children. Because too often we see all these poor, broken adults. And if we actually just gave them what they needed when they were children, they'd be wonderful, powerful, extraordinary beings. So I've concentrated on children. And yeah, I've written a series of books about them and future.
That's amazing. I can see that you have a lot of talents. You did quite a lot. You studied so many different, what can I say, ways for you to express your creativity. How many books you wrote so far?
Well, actually, I've written quite a few because I've written. So these two are just the first two hard publishings of the children's books. So they're from a series called Transmissions from the Planet Zog, an imaginary planet that, of course, has a basis in reality. And the two characters are Milo and Teal, and they live on Zog. And it's how they live, what they do, and what's different. But then they help us on Earth. They help a whole group of children on Earth become awakened, powerful, creative, imaginative, empowered. And so the books move through, and they teach about things like as diverse as, build your own house, or how do you learn? How do you pursue something that's fascinating to you? To how do you deal with someone dying? What's death? So it's my way of going through the philosophy of life, and putting it into books for children. So those three, there's another one. The three books for children, and then I've written now about four different books for adults, one on singing, one on acting, one on looking at it's a handbook of 5D learning for children, how children learn, how you can work with them at home to help as a homeschooler, just understanding how children learn, what they need. And another book that just hasn't been published yet on creativity, how to activate it. So yeah, I find it's a nice medium to get complex ideas.
Yes, because you are a medium. You have a psychic skills too. Oh, sorry, by the way, I have the dog, which this is definitely. Oh, sorry. My dog is always barking, if there's somebody. So this is alive,
Well,
recording.
animals always say things, don't they? I had a near car crash the other day, which was fascinating. I escaped completely unscathed. Might have ended up in heaven. Yeah, dramatic. And my car rolled, and I got out with not one scratch. The only scratch I got at physio was I picked up a piece of rose thorn which had broken out of the hedge onto the road, and I wanted to take it off the road so no one got a puncture. So I picked up this piece of rose thorn and got one rose thorn prick in my thumb. That's the symbolic accident.
Yes,
I was scared, by the way, my cat that evening, because I was obviously still in a bit of shock, and she slept on my bed all night. She hasn't done it before, but she knew, animals.
Yeah. Animals, they always knew when, because they are super connected with us. They are antenna. They are more perceivers than what we are toward them. And they perceive us better than what we perceive them, basically. We can feel a bigger
love. This first book is called Birds of a Feather. And a lot of the stories in it are about how Milo and Teal learn to talk to a bird and listen to a bird and convey their ideas, what they want. And it's about how they interact with nature. But I was talking to our beautiful mutual friend, Oksana's daughter. Yes. That was her favorite bit of the book, was this bird. The story of how they learn to communicate with her. So there's a lot of that where nature will pop up and it's bringing symbols, ideas, messages, but also that fine-tuned awareness that we all have that we often just ignore and package up and don't use. So all of that is in these books too, because we know children are just chests of riches that a lot of isn't, you know, it's just hidden.
When I channel with myself, when I was a little girl, which I was full of creativity, and I was always, I traveled a lot with my mind. I learned to travel with my mind when I was a little girl. That's why I thought that definitely was something about me that was, I felt always different. Obviously, what I perceive about myself these days, but, and then now it basically makes sense because I needed to travel with my mind. To go to a safe place, to go to a fantasy place. All the children of this generation, they have too many, many distractions. And they, unfortunately, sometimes they mind stop the spirit to travel, to explore, okay? They are basically very, very grounded physically, and definitely hypnotized by this, you know, distraction that we know what they are, is that they are the PlayStations, the TV, TikTok programs, softwares that hypnotize, stop basically like a barrier, the child's mind to don't express, to don't travel, to don't progress. You have just to stay there, absorb, that's it. It's absorbing basically external vibrations with they are fake.
I do this so much in my teaching work, Ethesia. So, I'll talk to a child. We're in an acting lesson. Mm-hmm. And we talk about a script they're reading, something they've chosen. And, of course, you can see that script in a film, a movie, or you could read it as a script. You could often read the book. And there are different things that happen. Sometimes there's a radio show version. So you might have an audio. You might have audio and visual, where the director has plotted everything out for you on a movie screen, or you might have a book where your mind has to create the images and you travel with the author. And we talk about these things. We talk about how you can become hypnotized and lazy. I mean, a movie is a wonderful thing, but you're jumping into someone else's dream. You can be immensely manipulated. It can be fun, but it is someone else's dream. If you're reading a book, you have more power, more control, because your imagination is stimulated. If you write it, you have even more power and control. So we talk about these degrees of power in activating and the importance of it, because people just say, oh, daydreaming. They say, yes, it's important. You know, creativity is important, but they don't say why. They don't say what for. They don't look at the true deeper. So that's why it's like,
well,
we talk about this stuff, you know?
Exactly. And this is what basically you express in the books. This is what the children, they activate this power. They're starting to believe that it's not only a fairy tale. It's not only a story, that they can create their own story, because you inspire with your books the children to basically to explore more, to expand their creativity. That is amazing. And don't forget that children, they are recently coming back from a past life or for the future or wherever, you know.
I mean, look, here's an illustration. This is just a place that the children visit with their mother in a jungle village on Zog.
Wow.
This is a conference center they build in the jungle,
It's built of vanilla vines under the jungle trees.
That's nice. Okay.
So they can harvest all the vanilla, but it's also a place you can go and gather. And above is a village in the jungle where people hang out on platforms built by the trees because you can get, you know, plants to grow. So, oh, look, here's they're doing bungee jumping from the top of this. Oh,
lovely.
It's kind of everyday things, but these things don't exist on our planet.
Can you read a line for us?
When
they meet in this beautiful jungle of vanilla.
Let's go back to our vanilla jungle. This is the mother talking to Milo and Teal, her children. "There's no reason why you couldn't," replied one. "Perhaps if two of you were to sing it together, build the image of what precisely you're looking to achieve, then we can broadcast it wide across to the next 12 libraries. There should be enough young people eager to have a go with helping you, and we could always put them up in the guest room." So, okay, that's just something that's a very ordinary thing, but they're bringing in lots of different ideas, that the children's ideas are valid. Anyone, any adult could listen to them. They can be shared. So they're considered valuable, because I think this is the sign of the times we're in. Children have not truly been valued because we haven't learned to value our soul essences. And children are the nearest thing to a soul essence because they're so freshly new, come from source or wherever they've come on their travels. So a society that doesn't truly honour and value children in all of their essences and life force, imagination, creativity, is a broken one. And one which is healed and beautiful and going to build this fabulous new world is one that understands and honors and values it. And, you know, this book is about a world that does that. And so it just brings it a little bit nearer. It's quite every day, and yet it's not, because you don't have vanilla conference halls, you know, next door, but they do. So it's gathering all the most incredible, innovative work we've got on that planet, which is usually hidden away. You know, there are universities in the Netherlands that grow plant roots into forms that you can harvest and turn into handbags. You know, that's happening in the Netherlands right now. So I turn that into a normal thing on Zog, where they build fence panels and building elements, because they ask the tree to grow in a certain way, because they program crystals with a certain frequency of sound and vibration so that the trees will grow there. So I make this sort of extraordinary world, the fantastical world, to bring it right close and show it's possible. Because children know that.
That's amazing. It's amazing, because the children, they have infinity of ways to really express everything in memories. Because children are old adults, many adults' time, but this is why we come back in our childhood for a reason, to express better how the beautiful is the world, the eyes of a child. I really recommend these books, because I had the fortune to see your books, your draws, when you went to Reading to see me. And it was amazing. I mean, you have a special, way to express the colors, and your imagination is definitely wonderful. I really recommend every school in England to have a look about these beautiful books, because, I mean, it's important to starting to realize that we are making big changes, we are progressing in the future, but sometimes progress is not necessarily what we need, okay?
Well, there's different kinds of progress, aren't there? There's the thing we progress,
I mean, in a materialistic way, yes, because some progress is not good at all for children. This is what people want, but what they need is to be happy, is to be, to still express, and they're trying to, at the moment, well, this is my perception anyway, to basically stop people to think, to allow to have their own expression, because every expression, if it's around now, is all led by other sources. So like you said before, it's like, it's good to see a book, but it's somebody else's creation. That is good. I'm still reading. I like the minds of many people, but they are creating just a unique mind, and is making people very, very average. For some, I see less creativity than before.
Well, the school I work at is a uniquely beautiful, brilliant school. It wins lots of prizes, and that's why I've been there for 15 years. It's one of the loveliest places in England. But that's not your average school. You know, the average school in Britain, you'll have seen this, they go for, you know, wonderful mathematics and core subjects and the sciences, so-called sciences, most of what they taught is wrong, but anyway. And, you know, the music, the art, all of the creative subjects are just like, you know, guilty pleasures around the edge. When you think about parents in a family, they naturally, most families have love for their children, and they enjoy watching the beauty of their children, the funny, quirky ideas of their children, but they're still, it's still considered sort of the cute icing on the cake. But they really want the children to, you know, nestle down, do the homework, get the grades, do the exams. It's because our world is so topsy-turvy, so importance is put in the wrong place. And so this is all about, of course, turning it around the other way and saying, from the creativity, from the state of receptivity, you can receive and access all knowledge. There's a lot about that. It's all, you know, law of attraction, how you acquire knowledge, you know, how you find it, and then how you create. So there's a lot of information about sound and vibration and resonance. And I was thinking, can I market these? Can I show these books at this school that I've loved and been there for a long time? And up till now, I felt that I couldn't. I have done workshops with parts of the book, but I haven't gone in and say, hey, here's the book, because 2 years ago, we weren't yet ready as a people to talk about frequency and vibration and attraction and manifestation. That was just like woo-woo stuff. And now, because everyone's been so shaken up, it's much, much more ready to receive it. And now is the time. Now I feel it's like, yeah, you know, now we can bring this information.
It's the time, and we talk a lot in our, you know, weekly, you know, meetings with Oksana and Patrio Dave. We talk a lot about the frequencies of the planet that definitely is changing super fast, and it's amplified by, you know, everything, by the sea, by the sky, by the winds, by its elements, by the people, animals, nature. They are basically reacting to these frequencies. So this is why we want to make sure these frequencies are super positive as possible, in order to, you know, to express the best of us, not the worst. You, with your books, are expressing not only beautiful, you know, energy and hope for the future generation, but also beautiful vibrations through your books. And this is why I recommend.
Before we were recording, I love that point so much. I want to bring it up because it was so to the point that literature for children. There is some incredible literature out there, but it's mostly about a disaster that you recover from, a terror that you bounce back from, you know, incredibly negative ideas in these, incredibly well-written books, but there is the agenda is still very dark, that's going out to children. And it's usually about a terror that is recovered from, that it really is, or an argument that creates dismay and destruction. And I was so fed up with that. I love reading, and I'll read any children's book you give me because I want to appraise it and look at it and value it. But we needed books which were about being okay, getting brilliant, from okay, being a little bit sad, to being ecstatic. We didn't have those books. We didn't have the books that showed you how to remain happy.
Exactly. even to how to self-healing yourself, how basically to understand that you have the power, that you are a superhero. You don't need external help, or to wait that you can be destroyed by these bodies, the entities, and you have to feed them. You know, but every person they said we are children of God, because God is in ourselves. This is the way I perceive God. God with this is a essence, an entity that you can feel it, you know, with animal, with a plant, with anything, because we is the what we're breathing. And this we have to remind to the children, you know, as adults, that they are children of God. Let them be children of God, not to erase or delete their creativity, their power. I mean, when I say power, is the power of, when I say the words, convictions, determination, willing. You know, when you have this power, you are unstoppable. And what instead they do in these days is to erase, to delete these words, conviction, willing, and determination.
Yeah. Because and that sense of self-gets trodden on because they say, you're not you. Who are you to have your own ideas about what's good for you? You must listen to an authority. And this authoritarian thing is a big deal. You know, Philip Pullman wrote these incredible books for children, the whole Lyra series. The TV has been making this wonderful series, that his Dark Materials, there was a film made, The Golden Compass, a long time ago, and they are brilliant books. They're probably more for adults and teenagers. And he started to look at this idea of an authority always bearing down on us and saying, we have the right to tell you what to do, and then an inner essence that you can commune with and find out all you need to do. And that was brilliant that he was allowed to publish that. That was like an agenda release program. Okay, the Matrix now says you're allowed to bring this into the world. Thank goodness for this. But it was still, you know, there was one female figure who was feisty enough to kind of make her mark. But there was still this sense of chance, and not this sense of, when I am in connection with what I am made of, and I meet others, animal, leaf, plant, person, whoever, on that level, I'll just be moving synchronistically through my life with this joy, this passion, this excitement, which is our true nature. And we just had that denied, and a few of us have kept it alive. You know, watching your last beautiful work with Oksana on Italy, you know, that work, that's the kind of work we should be doing every day. Get up in the morning and do that.
This is why these evil forces, they're trying to, you know what I mean? They're basically they're moving the last strength that they have in the tail, you know, because they're losing the power. You know they are about to the desert, we say, you know, and this is why they're trying to keep us imprisoned emotionally and then physically. How we can find a way to keep these people completely shattered and in need with the economy to destroy you, and then with the fear of what, of a virus or whatever it is, fear and need together is what they want basically to give to you. Is a creation of them. You know, when we're talking about creation,
and it's very easy.
They teach me, even my parents, you know, which I love so much. My dad is not he's in spirit, you know, bless his soul. And my mom is still around, but they basically was taught to believe to other creations, to other stories, politics, religion, which is like religions which are fairy tales or nightmares for somebody.
Very useless control mechanisms, don't they?
Yes.
We can't blame our parents, we can't blame our grandparents. They were immersed in a system, a very cleverly worked out system, which denied us access to our own self-trust. And, you know, when you have no self-trust to that inner knowing which takes you back to all that is, then you just have fear and control in front of you. And so, of course, you're going to acquiesce and do what they tell you to do because you don't have a firm connection. And it's only us sort of stubborn souls who've known that, hang on a moment, you know, that's not the true story. And we've got louder and louder of late, which is so beautiful. And now it's the time to just stand up there and say, look, yeah, it's great that some adults are waking up, but we need this for all of the children. They know it. They just have to hide it. They have to deny it. It's enough, you know. We don't want them to have to do that anymore, to break their natures and fold them up in little boxes and behave
to satisfy some kind of organized society based on, currently it's this sort of money idea, but it's not really money, it's just the way we have used it as a very clever controlling mechanism to keep us away. Yeah.
Okay, that is amazing. I will want to ask you just a few questions with a with a very rapid answers, because we are out of the time. I would like to ask you, as a child, did you had a story, a book that is a book for children that really freaked you out, that you was afraid, that is still around, this book in the schools?
Okay, so when I was a child, I used to wake up every day and dress as a different fairy tale character. So I knew what was going on from quite an early age. trying to remind my parents of what life was, how we could be. So I was quite busy doing that from a very early age. But
yeah,
the first book that did freak me out was a Sleeping Beauty book.
Really?
Yeah, and they had this, super scary witch. And of course, there was the docile, very beautiful, but knocked out young girl, powerless. It was that pure showing of revelation of female powerlessness. Mm. She got an apple choked and she was out for the count for 100 years. That's quite dire. And that was interesting that affected me the most. It was just an illustration, that was scary. And I remember my brother and I, who was 2 years older than me, and we were both freaked out by this book. We'd kind of creep and look at it and just like, put it back in the bookshelf. But because that was such an important part, wasn't it? The female intuitive, receptive force on the planet being rendered powerless by an illusion, which looked quite beautiful to start with, but was really very evil and was borrowing the clothes of something beautiful to deceive. So,
It created even the image of the rich, powerful, beautiful man that, where is it? Because I never saw anyway. And you have basically by always the man that he has the money, you have to be poor and he will look after you. So even connecting the materialistic desires of a girl, I choose you, even if you are a washing up, guy in the McDonald's. But as long as you're rich inside and make me laugh, you treat me well. Because now the materialism is took the pick.
The thing is, the guy who looks after himself well and treats himself well wouldn't, of course, work in McDonald's for many reasons that you and I know, and perhaps some we can't discuss on here. But that kind of self-respect is, of course, way more valuable than gold. Yeah.
Obviously, it's good to have a person that is grounded, that can look to have a nice house. But in these stories, in these books, is really which, if you really check deep behind the walls, there is a different message. And be honest, they're not very nice. The seven, what it was, White Snow and Seven Dwarfs. Wow. What is your best book that you can give, like?
I just started rereading the Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe series again, because one of the things I'm doing on my website, most of my website is now about children, but I still have my music on there and other things, but I've got this little section where I'm starting to review books and films, movies for children.
Okay.
So I wanted to include this because I've been doing Philip Pullman books and various other ones. Now, the Land of the Wardrobe has got so many allegories. A lot of people are now talking about it. So Aslan, that big, powerful, loving lion, was Jesus Christ, but not as the church has talked about, but an essence of love and generosity. But then, the author, Charles Lewis, he put in ideas of sacrifice, which is like, again, it's a skewed story, but there are many really interesting truths and then some skewed truths. But my favorite of that series is The Last Battle, and we're in The Last Battle. And The Last Battle, I don't know if you've read it, but they move through a door. It's just like a doorway. If you walked around it, it would just look like a doorway standing on a hill, leading to nowhere.
Okay.
But at the last moment, they move through this doorway into another world, which is the same from where they've come from, but it's a higher vibrational world.
Ah, okay. I can put in my, you know, things to basically to have a look, because I have so many books to read. They're waiting for me. It's like, hey, Ephesia, remember me. I'm the book of last year. Ah, okay. Yes, I had a good book. Yeah. So I'm a year behind reading books. But yes, thank you for let us know this. Another question is, what is your vision of children? What you see children in the next, in the next 10 years, what are we going to achieve? They will be the same children of now that they are bombarded by a subliminal, materialistic, synergetic world, cyborgs, TikTok, where you have to be and whatever. Because what I see in TikTok is just people to have the visibility only to be, I don't know, even to be treated like as a weird. They are happy. Okay, I'm weird, but I know people, they can see me now, you know, I can have a lot of likes, which I don't know if
it's inside out as well, isn't it? It's like saying the skin is more valuable than the spirit within. TikTok, yeah, use it, but mostly people are being used and abused by it. So the way I want children to be is to be. There are some schools like this. So this vision is obviously through my own spirit, but I've studied in the PhD I did. You know, I went around, I wanted to find the schools that treated children well. And there were a few. There was one in Russia, the Tekos school in Russia. You Ooh. Might know this, Bringing Cedars of Anastasia, her book. They talk about that school. There's an amazing school in Ecuador run by some friends that my parents knew. Where the children are self-directed and they work according to what they're fascinated and passionate about, and the parents, the adults, just there to assist them. And there are a couple of other schools, okay? So I studied those, and that's how I want to see the children. So they have resources, they have things to manipulate, to use, to assess, to research with. They have adults to help them in that. They are allowed to work together, but they are actually independent in their process of learning, because they're unfolding their spirit's mission through their joy, excitement and enthusiasm. And that's possible because there are places doing it. And then, yeah, they use technology to help them, because it's fun to chat with someone in Australia if you're in England, or it's really fun to do a research project with someone in Iceland if you live in Kenya. Oh, you know,
technology can help us in use it in the right way. I mean, as long as they don't replace us, that we'll be completely mapped.
Yeah, because there's that sort of beauty perfection thing, which is just seriously scary, because we've forgotten that every human is asymmetrical and we've all got weird and quirks, and that's actually what makes us beautiful in real life. It's just we got used to these still beautiful images, you know, models being touched up by Photoshop, you know, scratch up skin there and everything. And you can see that crazy world. So yeah, I've had that lovely natural honouring. And children do it because they are actually beautiful with each other. It's really rare that you see kids being mean when they are loved and supported.
Okay, that's interesting. What color are you going to give to the world with this energy that you are giving to us tonight?
It's not going to be just one color, because I just love people sometimes say, you know, what's your favorite color? It's like,
all of them. What's your favorite? It can be what today you perceive, or what maybe. So
it's rainbow, you know, it's every color.
I was waiting for that.
It's about clarity of tone. It's every color is just heaven for me, but yeah. I don't like muddy colors. So for me, it's that kind of zingy clear. When I, my dad used to work with lasers, okay? And I used to spend time in his office sometimes getting bored because, I don't know, children have to hang out in their father's office sometimes when the mothers do something. And he had these spectrometers, which was like a laser printout of the spectrum. And I would just stare at this thing. That was like, so yeah, a rainbow, a very clear, high frequency.
Nice. Rainbow is beautiful. I had this in my mind, rainbow. I know we should say rainbow. And yes, I really would like to thank you. We are a bit off of the time. And the next time I can ask you to be my guest about Esoteric Chronicles experience from childhood and to understand what affected in the life of the persons, okay? Because we have to have more understanding about ourselves, our journey in this world through traumas, fears, you know, emotions, let's say even fate. The fate is when, we can't change something that happened, but we can reframe for sure.
If you embrace
your life. And you learn I'm okay, this is happening to me. All right, I can't change things, but what I learn and what I can make changes instead of to cry, to be the victim and to be, you know, against everybody treating me bad. No.
Yeah.
So we're going to call the chronicle of an esoteric life.
Yeah.
We have an esoteric life. We have an esoteric life. Even the people that don't believe in these things, they had and they will. Esoteric is part of current life, basically even to the people that they lost faith in themselves. Because for me, faith is not about religion. This is something that I completely disconnect myself. Faith is to the faith on you.
When they don't believe in something, the next part of the sentence they utter actually shows that they have belief. So they're just so contradicting, they don't even know they're doing it. So I think no one's actually truly lost their belief. We have just squished it and hidden it. And it's just like this massive spring that at some point we'll meet that tipping point and we'll all go, oh yeah, well, of course I knew that too. And we're just here to make that normal, to make that knowledge normal.
Exactly, that is good. That is amazing. Oh, you know what I can say? Thank you so much to be here. And people, please give a chance. Show them again your books. Put the show again. The first is a vibration works. Transmission from the planet Zog. And then this is the Birds of Feather, always a transmission for the planet Zog, which is a series that Isabella, she's right, she carry on writing. Please give to your child as a present, because that can be a wonderful, wonderful, a trip in this planet Zog, because it's expression, is fantasy, creativity.
That's so awesome.
Please, guys, let go. I will write down, check in my informations, and will explain where you can find Isabel, where you can connect with her to buy the books. And please put a like. And thank you
so much.
Ciao, ciao.